Hello and welcome. You're watching For Your Information. I'm Gargi Rawat. Today we're going to decode the hype around IPOs for you. What are IPOs? Well, an initial public offering or stock launch is a public offering in which shares of a company are sold to investors. The process marks the transition of a private company to a publicly listed firm. Now, unless you've been living under a rock for the last few days, there's been a lot of hype around the Zomato IPO, and it's the biggest public offering in more than a decade at 9,375 crore, and it's been oversubscribed 38 times. That's not all. Even more IPOs are lined up later in this year. In fact, Paytm has filed papers for the biggest IPO ever at 16,600 crore. So a lot of hype, a lot of exuberance, enthusiasm in the market over these IPOs. But if you're a retail investor, does it make sense for you to invest in these companies? Because if you scrutinize their balance sheets or look at their declarations, well, these companies have not been making big profits. In fact, they've been making losses. So what does it hold for you in the future? Though for the startup sector, this is definitely great news and a big boost. Well, to talk more about this, we're now joined by Dhirendra Kumar, founder and CEO, Value Research, Ambarish Baliga, stock market expert and investor, and Krishna Kumar, founder and CEO, Cropin Technology, Bengaluru. Thank you so much for joining us. And Dhirendra Kumar, I'd like to start with you. What do you make of all this hype and a lot of enthusiasm for the Zomato IPO? But what's your reading of it? Should a retail investor have gone for it?
No, they would not have missed on anything by not going for it. Because, you know, you'll be surprised that, you know, as recent as 2015, it was not possible for investors, any company which is making losses to go public. So that's one. Then there is another thing which one should take note of. And, you know, that is why, generally speaking, all IPOs are avoidable. Because that is, you know, very unlike, you know, buying a stock in the market where you have, there is a buyer and a seller. In case of an IPO, there is a complete asymmetry. The seller knows everything and the buyer knows barely anything. And, you know, he has to read a voluminous thing and try and make sense of whatever it is. And third is that, you know, I'm actually reminded of a joke on this, that, you know, people, if you don't have facts, if you don't have law, then you have to hammer on the table what a judge was told. So I'm just thinking that, you know, this was all hype.
And all right, but how do you explain this hype? So much enthusiasm, it's been oversubscribed 38 times.
Because people are used to the product. People are used to the Zomato guy coming and delivering things. So being familiar with it, they think that we have seen it time and again. But business is a very hard thing to do in terms of doing a massive thing, serving customers and making money at the end of the day, and making money in a manner that it is sustainable. Sustainability of the profit. You know, it is not about, you know, somebody selling an IPO or managing a business is not about finding an investor. It is not about finding a bigger fool, because, you know, somebody bought, then somebody sold, then somebody, and then you're someday that musical chair comes to an end. If the business is not standing on its feet and if it is not on a wicket where it can sustain itself profitably.
All right, Ambarish Baliga, your view?
Companies like Zomato, I think it's very difficult to value them, because listed entities, the proper profit track record are valued differently. But these PE-funded startups, which are, I mean, although they are mature, they are showing revenue, but they yet to show profits, and they are still cash guzzlers. So first of all, it's quite difficult to value this. My generation can actually relate to Hindustan Unilever or a Colgate. I think it's the same way these millennials are relating to Zomato. And possibly what we saw in HUL decades back, we are possibly seeing that in Zomato today. But somehow, I am not able to convince myself to really apply for this issue. Neither did I apply for it. And if you look at the numbers, if you look at the FY24, 3 years hence, we are talking of the valuation of 5 times revenue of FY24. If you look at last year's revenue, it's about 30 times. I don't know as to how you can value it like that. And at the same time, it is not number one. Swiggy is number one, although Zomato is
number
two. Swiggy is number one. And then you have Amazon, which has got into the space. They have deep pockets, which surely someone like a Zomato, which is dependent on now public money, may not really have those pockets. And then you have the trustee body, which is fighting with it regarding the commissions, client to, I mean, have their own app. I don't know as to how that's going to work out. And then just like Nazara, which was listed recently, after listing, we saw a lot of fee investors selling out. So something like that can happen in Zomato. And one important and interesting fact which I saw was, I mean, all retail and institutions were applying for Zomato, but the employees opted out. The employee portion is 50% subscribed.
Yes.
There are 60,000 shares, 3,500 employees, which means about 2,000 shares per employee. They could have applied, but that is only 50% subscribed. So I think although the issue is over, but then I see something similar to what possibly happened in 2009, as far as Reliance Power is concerned. It was a lot of hype. I mean, there was nothing on the ground. People just put the money for the name, and we have seen what's happened. I don't know whether something similar can happen to Zomato. But then what we have seen in the history, the last 20 years, whenever huge IPOs like these have come, I mean, the markets have also corrected.
Right. But you talked about it difficult to evaluate these companies, and tech companies are different from, you know, brick and mortar companies. And that's always been a challenge. But there's so much hype around them, not just in India, abroad as well.
No, that's true. But then again, I mean, we need to see as to where it will stand in the next 3-4 years. But then, I mean, I've given you those risk factors. You could possibly have someone like Amazon actually coming, taking over, like in this race. At the same time, the whole user body, which is the restaurants association, is completely against you. They are trying to find some other way out. And at the same time, you have Swiggy, which is launching a new app. Actually, they've already launched it yesterday, which will help the restaurant body reduce the commission rates, and that could be negative for Zomato because they also will have to do something similar.
All right, Krishna Kumar, I'm sure your view is something totally different. A great time to be a startup in India, and this is going to, you know, lead to a big boost in the sector.
Yeah, I mean, this is a very exciting time for the startups, and this was much more needed because, you know, everybody was looking at how do we get the exit. If you look at all the large investors who are coming and pouring money in the country. Now, this is a great validation, and you will see more and more investors coming in with the large ticket size because now there is a path to exit for them. And tech companies are very, very different. I was hearing the view of our panel members.
Yes.
But tech has a very different appetite, right? You invest for the future. Look at Amazon. They were not profitable for a very, very long time. Look at Google. They didn't know how to generate revenue. I think it's a time for India to become a product company and global tech company. And I think these are some of the measures and some of the, you know, IPOs which are happening. I'm sure in next one decade, we'll have a global company compared to the likes of Google and Twitter, which has been created in the Silicon Valley. If you look at Zomato, I'm very bullish about it because I heard the founder talking in one of the conclaves, and he mentioned that we are not just a food company. We are a data and health company as well. We want to ensure the safety, and I want the moms to go and order on the Zomato because today they don't want their children to eat Zomato food because they think it's coming from the hotel. Can I control that? Can I also make the kitchen more safer? Can I supply the fruits and vegetables to those kitchens and ensure the quality of it, right? So I think they are thinking like a data company, and they are thinking like a, you know, even the mom to order, and it's a go-to brand today, Zomato, I've already applied for the IPO, and I'm excited. This is a very, very exciting time. I think you will see a lot of foreign investors coming to India and taking their bets on these new age tech companies. And you rightly said, you know, we can't compare them with the likes of brick and mortar companies. And I remember Aditya Birla had their own online platform, and they shut down, and they said, no, we don't have appetite to burn money like Flipkart or other guys. Of course, I mean, new generation, entrepreneur has got a very different appetite. They are thinking differently. They will keep investing in the deep tech, and they will have negative balance sheet for some time. But you will see them, I'm bullish that they will emerge stronger from India. Yeah.
And this year is a year of IPOs. It's not just, Zomato. You've got Paytm coming up with the biggest IPO offering ever. And then you've got a whole bunch of them lined up after that.
I mean, there are 40 unicorns in the country, and you know, in last four, I mean, the start of the year, if you look at from Jan to April, there were 10 unicorns compared to the whole year last year, where we had we got 11 unicorns, and I think all these guys will be looking for, you know, maximizing and going through IPO route when the time is right. And you know, NASSCOM is predicting we will have 100 unicorns in 2025. Then you know, what is the way out? I think it's a great show. And look at Nazara Technology, right? It's a gaming company from India doing so well. They went for IPO, and I'm sure they, you know, they bring a lot of promise in the future as well. Look at US market, right? There is a SPAC route. There's so many companies who are on the negative balance sheet. They are going and filing for IPO through the SPAC route. And why not India? I mean, we have a lot of great unicorns and deep tech companies, product companies, and you know, there should be a fair chance for them to also raise public
right.
money.
All right, Dhirendra Kumar, come in here. To invest in these IPOs, you need to have a long-term outlook. Isn't that something, you know, that is short? You can't invest in them thinking short-term. You need a long-term view. Also, I just want to read out what Amitabh Kant, CEO, Niti Aayog said, and he had tweeted that IPOs will drive our startup revolution. Indian startups raising money in Indian markets from Indian public, a wonderful time to be a startup in India. So that, you know, that enthusiasm is something, you know, good to see.
Yeah, undoubtedly. Everybody is very enthusiastic. Even investors are enthusiastic. They are queuing up to put their money. I have my opinions about this because, you know, what Krishna Kumar was saying, that, you know, when Google was incubating or Amazon was incubating, they were actually building a great product. They were building a great product, which was, you know, which we know that, you know, AWS is a big leap. Amazon is expanding globally, and, you know, the unit economics is very much favorable. Google is not replicable. This is something, you know, where a lot of wealthy people have funded a company and they have gone about distributing it to investors and actually served them food. And that has been consumed. That is my concern. The unit economics at some place, you know, you have to really need a roadmap whereby in some defined time frame, one should be making money. That's one. The other is that I have, you know, great distaste or disdain for, you know, one particular aspect. That these are the kind of investment which venture capitalists are very much within their rights to do it. It's their money. Exactly, you know, Mr. Birla pulled out the plug simply because it was his money. The people who are managing these businesses, it is not their money. That's my concern. And, you know, it's so, you know, other people's money being manned by people and who are just into, you know, spending it and may not be necessarily wisely. And of the 40 companies, if 35 companies actually fail for a venture capitalist and 5 of them succeed big time, they are done. They are successful. They are nice. They are hugely successful. For an individual investor, his money goes down the drain too.
Okay. Well, Ambarish Baliga, I'd like to ask, you know, as I said, there's so many IPOs now lining up. Zomato's ended today, then we have Paytm, we have others coming up. The timing is very unusual, like, or is it? Why is it that we're seeing all these IPOs coming around roughly the same time?
Timing is not unusual, because whenever the secondary markets have boomed, after a certain while, you have an IPO boom, and this has happened every time. I think the only difference between, the earlier such booms and this boom is that we don't have so many fly-by-night operators who had come with an IPO just to take advantage of the situation and give the public. That is not happening now, fortunately, because there are tougher norms, good oversight by the regulators. So at least that will not happen on the main board IPOs. But then at the same time, I think people need to be a bit careful because, most of these companies are not really showing profits. We don't know as to when they will show up profits. And at the same time, we don't know as to, a few of them could also go down the drain for all you know. They may be those billion-dollar companies, unicorns, but then it is possible that they can go down the drain. So I don't think, this is my view that these companies are still not, they should not have come out with an IPO at this sort of time, because the secondary market is meant for companies which are profitable, which have a decent track record, at least for the last couple of years. As far as these companies are concerned, they have a track record, but they are not profitable.
All right, and so you actually feel they should not have come out at this time with an IPO?
See, I mean, from the point of view of the company investors and management, I think this is the best time. But from the investors' perspective, possibly, I mean, these investors should not be applying. But then, because the IPO has come, there's a lot of hype around this IPO. People have applied because everyone has made money in the last 15, 17 months. So liquidity is available, and there's a lot of hype. And that's the reason you apply. And exactly that's what I told about Reliance Power. It was the same thing.
Okay.
There was so much of hype at that sort of time that if you're not applying for Reliance Power, there's something wrong with you.
maybe people want to be a part of this story, the startup story, you know, in India. Krishna Kumar, if we talk about Paytm, which is the next IPO, it's coming up at some point. And in its prospectus, it says that we expect to continue to incur losses for foreseeable future and may not achieve profitability. So, and this means very little promise in terms of dividends. So if so, why should investors, you know, invest in this?
Look, I mean, Paytm is going to going for IPO, and they will keep raising capital as well, right? So the deep tech company need capital, and it takes time for you to, you know, you have a choice. Either you stop the growth and be operationally profitable or show the, you know, positive dollars, or you make a choice that you want to, you know, take a larger bet and you want to do a larger play. And that's the bet you take, and I think these guys are taking it head on, right? So they will go for IPO. I think great leadership, great pool of investors there, and they will be putting right governance as the IPO is a, you know, public. You know, you're going public, and you have to have a right governance, right guidance, and they are taking all the measures. I'm sure they will take all the measures, right? And they are also well aware of this is public money and need to be respected. At the same time, public also knows where he's investing. I mean, this is a bet you are taking in the market. Who knows, you know, tomorrow what happens to these tech companies. I think India has not seen IPOs and investment in the deep tech companies. That's why you see the foreign investor coming in, taking the bets in India. You not see corporate houses coming so forward with large check. And that's a gap I see, you know, because they don't understand the tech. Basically, and I have seen recently,
right.
You know, Tata Digital. Look at Tata Digital, what they're doing. They're creating an ecosystem of digital companies, taking larger bets and making larger investment, because now these guys are going to lead the way, and some of the, I mean, you'll see these things happening now, and also taking the cue from the US, you know, that's what happening at the SPAC route. I think good direction. And I'm very hopeful.
All right, there is a good direction, and you're hopeful. We'll slip into a short break now. On the other side, I want to talk about the other, you know, IPOs coming up. We spoke about Paytm, and which are the ones that, you know, Dhirendra and Ambarish are looking forward to. That's coming up after this break. Welcome back. Well, on FYI today, we're discussing IPOs, and does it make sense for a retail investor to invest in them? There's a lot of hype, a lot of enthusiasm. If we take a look at some of the upcoming IPOs today, Zomato has been subscribed 38 times, over 38 times. You have Paytm coming up. That's going to be the biggest IPO ever. You have Flipkart, MobiKwik, Ola, and Policy Bazaar, Nykaa, some of the IPOs that are coming up this year. Dhirendra Kumar, I'd like to ask you, which of these IPOs is the one that you would be interested in?
No, I won't be excited about any of the IPOs. In fact,
any
I'm very up. Any of them. I'll be very excited about many technology companies. I will be willing to invest in them. I, in fact, encourage investors to be investing in a technology company, global technology company. There are many vehicles through which you can invest. You know, if you want to invest in the top 8 largest technology companies in the world, you have a fund called Fang Plus. It invests in all the largest 8 new age technology companies. If you want to invest in a larger set, you can invest in the Nasdaq 100. They are profit making, very well, you know, intensely scrutinized businesses. Many of the Indian businesses that we are coming across They are far from being a very realistic business, and I think they are they still have to evolve and formalize their business model. I'll be excited about any of these business models, where businesses, when they get closer to, even if a lot of money is left on the table.
Right.
Maybe
right.
I'm old-fashioned like Amrish, because, I've lived in the 90s. I have seen a time when, every week there used to be 150, IPOs come to the market, hit the market. And in 3 years' time, investors, that money just disappeared. It vaporized.
All right, Amrish, your view on this, any IPOs that you're excited about, and there's enthusiasm to be a part of this startup story. That's how it's being hyped up as well.
Yeah,
that it's a part of India's success story.
Yeah, in fact, I would be a bit positive as compared to Zomato. I would look at Paytm slightly positively, because although they have said they'll not make profits in the near future, at least foreseeable 4 to 5 years, hopefully they should be in the black. But then the only issue with Paytm is, I think it's a huge issue. I think it's about 15,000 crores plus $2.2 billion dollar issue. So I think that could be a small negative as far as Paytm is concerned. And the other issue which I'll surely look at positively is Nykaa, because they've been able to establish the brand very well as a retailer, as a private label, especially with the millennials. So at the same time, they have also turned profitable. I think that is very important, because you can be burning venture capital money. But then, basically, they are those mature investors. But then, when you come into the market and you're dealing with the retail investors, who actually invest more on hype than anything else, and it is good as long as the music is on, everything is good. But then, after that, we have seen what has happened in the past. So, like I said, from that point of view, I would possibly look at Paytm and Nykaa positively.
All right, and Krishna Kumar, your view, and also will this, the hope is this is going to translate into more, job creation and do well for our economy.
Yeah, I'm sure that's the outcome of this kind of a race. I'll be bullish on Ola because recently they also launched a two-wheeler factory in Chennai, changing the way the mobility is going to happen in India. And who knows, tomorrow they come with the autonomous vehicle or electric car, and those could be future plans. And I think I'm going to support the Indian entrepreneurs. We want these tech companies to grow and take head on global competition. Why there should be only one Tesla, right? So there is enough room in the market, and if you do it well, and
all right,
I'm closely watching that. Yeah.
All right. Well, great to know. Well, thank you so much, everyone, for joining us on the show and giving us your view and, talking about the Indian IPO story. Lots of IPOs coming up, and really we've tried to give you as much information about whether it makes sense or not to invest in them. Thank you for watching. Goodbye.